Simon & Schuster Audio presents Obsession. The FBI's legendary profiler probes the psyches of killers, rapists, and stalkers and their victims, and tells how to fight back. By John Douglas and Mark Olshaker. Read by Danny Campbell. For Jack Douglas, March 19, 1918, to May 14, 1997. Father, friend, and our greatest supporter. With love and the hope you're just as proud of this one. 1. Motivation X. They were all dead, all four of them, the entire family. It was 1979. I sat at my desk at Quantico, concentrating on the color crime scene photos. Mr. and Mrs. Kenneth Peterson were in the bedroom of their one-story wood home in this medium-sized mid-Atlantic city. He on the bed, his wife Sarah, nude on the floor, her head sprawled to one side. Both had been bound with black electrical tape and white Venetian blind cords, which, from the ligature marks encircling their necks, appeared to be the means of death. Thankfully, their eyes were closed, but there was no peace evident on their bloodied and swollen faces. 11-year-old Melissa was in the basement, bound upright by white cords and tied by her neck to a drain pipe. She was gagged with a towel, naked below the waist except for her socks, panties bunched around her ankles. I stared at the close-up of her head, her long, dark hair sprawled in matted tufts across her face. She looked as though she had been a pretty girl, but it's always hard to tell from crime scene photos. Violence robs a person of so much. Violent death robs her of everything. Daniel, nicknamed Danny, was only 9. He was lying on the floor of his own bedroom next to his bed, fully clothed, bound with cord, with a plastic bag over his head. Whatever other wounds were evidenced on each body, both kids also died from ligature strangulation. The butchery had occurred between about 8 and 10 o'clock on a Wednesday morning in February of 1974, more than 5 years ago. Now there were 2, possibly 3 more killings, and an unknown subject, unsub, still apparently active. That's why the local police had called us in. The names and some of the details in this case have been changed for reasons that will become apparent. The facts, however, speak for themselves. I studied the other pictures in the Peterson file and the detectives' reports. Despite the mayhem at the scene, this was not a haphazard or opportunistic crime. There was no sign of forced entry. But one photo showed that the telephone line had been cut before the intruder entered the house, and a search by detectives indicated that the binding cord had been brought to the scene. Whoever had done this had it all planned out. I was unclear what, if anything, was missing from the house, but the family car had been stolen. Police found it abandoned in a food store parking lot. In 1979, our profiling program was just getting established. I'd only been at Quantico for 2 years, first as a National Academy counselor, then as an instructor, after serving stints as a field agent in Detroit and then Milwaukee. FBI Director William Webster had recently given the Behavioral Science Unit official approval to offer psychological profiling consultation as an adjunct to our educational and research responsibilities. A few years later, I would be the first to move over from training to full-time profiling, but at this point, my main job was still teaching, specifically the applied criminal psychology course given to new agents and police fellows from around the United States and the world. Bob Ressler, Roy Hazelwood, and a few of the other instructors were also starting to consult as their teaching schedules allowed. Even though we were new and still relatively unknown, we'd already developed a procedure. Send us your crime scene photos and officer-on-the-scene accounts, witness statements, autopsy photos, protocols and medical examiner reports, maps of crime scenes and/or body dump sites, anything else that might be relevant to the case. Tell us anything you know about the victims, their habits, their lifestyles. But don't give us your suspect list, if you have one, or tell us who you think might have done it. We don't want to be influenced by your opinion. Kenneth Peterson was 41 at the time of death. His wife, Sarah, had been 34, the same age I was now as I sat here reading this. Kenneth had retired from the army, where he'd been stationed in Germany. He came with his family back to the United States, settled in this pleasant eastern seaboard city, and worked as a pilot and mechanic at a small airfield just south of the metropolitan area. Roughly a month before, the Petersons had moved into the house in which they died. I glanced through the cold clinical facts of the four autopsy reports. Just as the crime scene photos suggested, all four of them had died of asphyxia due to compression of the larynx by ligature, causing pulmonary edema and congestion of the viscera. There were other wounds on Sarah, and the gross description noted that Melissa was also wearing a white bra, which had been cut in the front. Yet there was no evidence of sexual assault on either female. Though there were no bullet wounds on any of the bodies, I figured he had to have had a gun. Otherwise, he couldn't have controlled that many people at the same time, particularly when one was a former military man. But clearly, he never intended to use the gun, except as a last resort to save his own life. He definitely went in intending to kill. No chance this was a burglary or robbery gone bad. But he wasn't interested in killing quickly and cleanly with a bullet. The police had come up with a number of well-publicized suspects, but none of them was strong. Then, in October, a local newspaper editor received a phone call directing him to look in a particular book in the main branch of the public library. Inside was a letter purporting to be from the killer. It claimed that the suspects the police had examined know nothing at all. To authenticate his claim of responsibility under the heading Peterson Case, he typed out specific descriptions of each victim, including position, type of binding, clothing, and means of death. He also threw in additional random comments under each victim, such as the fact that Kenneth had thrown up and that Sarah had not made the bed. He even complained that the car he stole was dirty inside and practically out of gas. I read the grayish photocopy, each sheet protected by a plastic sleeve. "What are you going to tell me about yourself from this?" I wondered. The text that followed the descriptions was only semi-coherent, going on for several paragraphs about how hard it was to control himself and that, since the murders, he didn't have any effective way of dealing with the urge to kill, since he couldn't approach anyone else about his problem. "When this monster enters my brain, I never know, but it is here to stay. How does one cure himself? If you ask for help after you have killed four people, they will laugh or hit the panic button and call the cops." In a way, it reminded me of the crime scene plea of William Herons, the 17-year-old college student serial killer in 1940 Chicago, who had used the lipstick of one of his victims to scrawl on her wall, "For heaven's sake, catch me before I kill more. I cannot control myself." He had been caught and attributed his kills to a George Merman, probably short for Murder Man, who he eventually acknowledged lived inside him. He was tried and sentenced to life in prison, where Bob Ressler and I had recently interviewed him as part of our criminal personality research project. The difference, though, was that whereas there might have been something heartfelt in Heron's lipsticked plea, this guy was playing with his audience. He described his modus operandi, M.O., following them, checking up on them, waiting in the dark, waiting, waiting. Like Heron's, he attempted to split off responsibility, saying, "Maybe you can stop him, I can't. He has already chosen his next victim or victims, and I don't know who they are yet." Then finished the note with, "Good luck with your hunting," before signing off, "Yours truly, guiltily." He added a P.S. "Since sex criminals do not change their M.O., or by nature cannot do so, I will not change mine. The code words for me will be search and destroy. That was the key, I realized. Not only is he taking credit for the murders, he's putting his own stamp on them, giving himself a persona. Whatever else this guy has accomplished in life, and my guess it wasn't much, this was the thing he was most proud of. This is the thing he spends most of his time thinking and fantasizing about. He sees himself as an artist, and this is his art, his life's work. The second part of the letter is just an explanation, a facile excuse for why he's going to keep doing it. This is what makes him feel most...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.